एवरीवन, आई एम अगेन हियर विद अ न्यू टॉपिक कॉल्ड मल्टीमीडिया डेटाबेस। सो टुडे वी आर डूइंग एन एक्सटेंसिव यूज ऑफ मल्टीमीडिया कंटेंट फॉर ई लर्निंग। लाइक वी हैव एन यूट्यूब, इन दैट वी कैन वॉच द वीडियोज, वी कैन लिसन द सॉन्ग्स, वी कैन वॉच द मूवीज ऑनलाइन। So we use the multimedia content everywhere. So before going into detail about what is multimedia database, the knowledge associated with multimedia database has to be made directly accessible. But the searching or accessing the multimedia content is still a challenging task. And therefore, we use the multimedia database. So what is a multimedia database? The multimedia database is the database that hosts one or more primary media file types. Now, what are the primary media file types? It can be a .txt, that is a document or handwritten document. It can be a audio with an extension .mp3. It can be an image with an extension .jpg, .bmp, .png, or it can be a video like AVI video, WMV, MKV, MPEG. Now, what is the multimedia data? Multimedia data is loosely fall into two main categories. The first one is a static media, which is a time independent because it is a static. It doesn't have any relationship with the time. That is the images and handwritten documents. And second one is the dynamic media. Every dynamic media has a certain time limit. The video plays for a certain time. The audio plays for a certain time. So it has a relationship with the time, and therefore it is a time dependent. So dynamic media contains videos or sound bites. And these, all the primary media files are stored in a binary strings of zeros and ones and are encoded according to their file types. Now, how the multimedia data is different than the normal data like string or any other data? So multimedia data is large, and because video takes more memory in a computer, and since it is large, it affects the storage. And since it is a large, the retrieval and the transmission of multimedia files becomes hard, or it will take more time than the other data. In case of a video and audio databases, time to retrieve the information is more than the normal database. As the size of the data is large, we need a certain special data structure for extraction and indexing. So which data structure we are going to use? We are going to use the enhanced multimedia meta object. In short, we can say it as EMO. EMO is an enriched knowledge unit of multimedia content, which comprises the media aspect, semantic aspect, and functional aspect. And it also supports the version aspect of each multimedia object. Now, what is the media aspect? The media aspect contains the multimedia files like video, audio, images, that is in the form of binary strings. We can store the video or images in the binary format. The semantic aspect, we have a relationship with video and its slides. Like one video has many slides. One slide has a start time, end time. These type of relationship contained in a semantic aspect. The third one is the functional aspect. Whatever be the action involved on a multimedia object, that contains in a functional aspect. Now, IMO is a formal entity which comprises the four parts. Logical media part. Logical media part means, in short, we can say it as a LMP. LMP means the multimedia files, that is the audio, images. Ontology object. Ontology object means every video has some attributes, like its author or creator, like that. Association. Association can be that one video uses these many slides. This that kind of relationship means association. And IMO nodes contains all these logical ontology and association. It forms one IMO node. We will see this using a CS101 lecture. This is a one IMO entity. In that, we have a lecture video. See here. In that, we have a lecture video. Lecture video uses the PPT. It has a lecture slides. Okay. And the lecture video has a LMP, this, through the URI. Now, what is the ontology here? The lecture video has a topic. Topic has a value, introduction to programming. These are the attribute, topic. This LMP is a kind of video. Now, this lecture video has a creator attribute and which has a value Eklavya. And the speaker of this video is Professor D.B. Phatak. Now, this is for, and one more, the format here. The format is MP4. That is the, if because of IMO, we can get the smallest information like the format, FFmpeg, it is a media codec, audio codec is HAL, and it is a full, because we are using the full video, therefore it is a full. Now the lecture slides. The lecture slides also has a author, that is the Professor D.B. Phatak. It has a format PPT, number of slides 29. Now each slide has a timing, start time and end time. That is, first slide will start from 0 to 1 minute 4 second. As soon as the topic will change, the next slide will play on 1 minute 4 second to 2 minutes 35 seconds. Like that, all the slides will play according to their topic. Now, this is the IMO representation for CS101 lecture. Now, how can we implement the IMO in our database? IMO is nothing but a model for giving the information. You don't need to learn the IMO, but it is just a structure which, it is just a pattern which designs the database as that we can use or we can access easily or we can retrieve or insert the multimedia data from the database easily. So, for implementation, we have to realize on a distributed infrastructure. We need to have a tables in a distributed manner so that we can get the smallest information from it. It is intended to enable the sharing and collaborative authoring of multimedia content, and we are going to use the any of the technology for creating the database like PostgreSQL or MySQL. We have to implement this IMO so as it becomes a platform independent and must be scalable. I am requesting Mr. Nagesh will talk you better on.
So this is a MO model, that is enhanced multimedia meta objects. Actually, there is a PhD thesis, maybe 2003, something like that, by Sonia Zillner. So this model actually gives you a power of representing information. Now previously we had just normal databases. Now for databases you have to design certain schemas. Right, certain schemas are there, like you want to say employee as a table, then employee code, then employee name, So you have to know the ontology well in advance. Ontology is something like, say, Eskimo. An Eskimo says this is white snow. So Eskimo may even say this is a black snow, green snow. But for me it is a white snow. Now if I can say white snow for me, for Eskimo, I'll have to tell him more information to say that this is a black snow. For me it may be white snow. For me snow is white. For you also maybe. Snow is white or black. You've not seen green snow? No? Green snow? Oh, there are green snow, brown snows, different. So it's like, you know, you're trying to match, you know, what are the meaning of this, you're trying to match with something else. So two different communities may have different meaning for the same thing, or you want to come to an agreement, one agreement, that is ontology. So why do we need ontology? I'm not sure why do we not need ontology, but it's always useful, because when we design databases, ontology is right inside the database. You don't see it. You only know the schema of it. So this is little mathematical, but I think it's understandable. It's only set theory, nothing else. So set theory, I mean, you must have had introduction set theory, right? Quite easy. So now this model actually is based on a 13 tuple model, 13 tuple. So what it says is that you can represent any information in this 13 tuple. Any information. You want to represent time, you want to represent spatial data, like GIS, geographical information systems, or if you want to represent even time independent things, 4 dimension, 5 dimension, 10 dimension, so any structure you can represent. So you can see that W, an entity, is a 13 tuple. Now every tuple will have a unique identifier, just to identify that it is unique, because in databases you need to know what is unique, right? Otherwise you will not be able to locate it where it is. So certain unique identifier is given to that particular tuple, and then you have a name of that W. What else is there? Kind. So there are 4 different kinds of objects. So one is LMP, as he had already said, LMP, logical media part. Second one is your ontology. Third one is association. Fourth one is MO. Now these 4, they are all different. Say LMP actually denotes the actual resource that you are having. Now you want to do something with that resource, the file, media, this, that, whatever, the proper resource. Ontology gives you relationships, you know, between different resources. You want to say CS101 lecture in IIT Bombay, and you want to say CS101 lecture in Stanford University. How do you say they are the same? Like a white snow and a green snow. There is a slight difference, but you want to say that they are same, because there is some programming involved in that lecture, in those lectures. So that is ontology. The third one is associations. You want to associate. After this lecture, this lecture. Second lecture. third lecture, fourth lecture. There's a temporal activity there. Or you want to represent much of the time related things, or much of the, you know, versioning mechanism. Like I took a lecture from Stanford University and I made my own lecture, but then I modified say 1/4 of it, but remaining 3/4 is the same. So then I can keep a track saying that this is the original one, this is the modified one. I put a timestamp. So I know from where I have copied. So that is the association. And MO itself, it's in a hierarchical fashion. So it keeps on encapsulating everything. So if I go to a figure, this is about Dracula movies actually. All different Dracula movies. So this is Dracula movie, I think this is the original one. This is the original one. This was created from this. So there is a predecessor and a successor. The whole thing is an MO. I can actually put the whole thing in an MO. Understand? So it's all hierarchical. So I have predecessor, successor, I have predecessor, successor, version 1, version 3, version 2 is here, version 3 is there. Like this. This is the way you would actually like to represent. It's a complete information that you would like to store in a database. So how do you do that? If you had to design a system without considering this model, this is a model, and the design itself will be different. This is a model. So if you had to consider doing a database design without considering this, then the database might be very huge. You have heard of temporal databases. They are special databases which take care of only time. Databases which take care of only time. So they are temporal databases, they're special databases. They are not normal databases. You must have heard of PostGIS or PostgreSQL, MySQL. MySQL will not consider time. PostgreSQL will not consider time. PostGIS will consider special information like related to GIS, geographical information. So there are time DBs which take care of only time. So different types of databases are there for special use. Now what we want one which can have everything. So if the database is not taken care, you have to take care at the model level. And what is that they are trying to do is that they want to take this model and put it down, break it in the form of a schema down, so that the redundancy is removed. Because in fact there is a redundancy. If I'll show you some examples. So this is an example. The logical media part, LMP, that's a unique ID number, and based on that 13 tuple. So if anything that you want to represent, you put a 13 tuple at the model level. This is a model level. Then the name, then it says it's an LMP, logical media part, kind. So there is an LMP there. Then those are null and null. I mean, those are null and null. And you, in many places, you will find. Sorry. Okay. Now you see there are many places where it is 5555555. That means nothing is there. So if you want to represent even a small thing like somebody as a researcher, which is an ontological object, whatever is O, O is ontological object. So I want to represent ontological object. I want to represent association object. I have to represent logical media part as an object. Okay, this is just a representation. What you see is a representation. So I have ontology. This is the ID, and then I have everywhere null. So if you do like this in the database, then it will take long time. I mean, lot of time to actually retrieve particular information. So now what they have done is that they have converted this type of data which is coming, you know. So they have converted into a brief schema is available, and they have some problems also. Now the problem is some of the information to fetch is actually taking time. Even after doing that, it's taking more time. So probably your job would be to improve that, right? Yes, Parag. So improve, you know, the performance of the system, because nobody would like to wait for 5 hours. If you press coming after 5 hours, nobody like to wait. Are there any questions? So now you see a bigger MO. Like this is one inside one MO is there. This is MO.
Model.
This big one. So INSPIRE is an association. Whatever is like this is association. So you have Remake, Vampire, Dracula. So they are inspired by. So you have to create those associations. You have to create those ontological objects, and you have to create. I mean, not you have to create. I mean, you should allow a person like me who doesn't know anything. I mean, a layman, to create something like this. So you have to. You should be able to map it that this is an association object, and then it goes inside a database and sits properly. Like for example, if you have a form and then you say name, roll number, this, where it should go, you have to identify. Or somebody is putting a lecture video, somebody is putting a slide, where it will go. So those connections you have to identify and provide that path. So this is mostly an authoring tool. You will not go and go inside the database and put labels and things like that. So you'll have to provide something which automatically takes and puts it there. And how you connect, you want to show that they are inspired. You create an object inspired, and then you may want to search, is there another word in the dictionary which is same as inspired, because ontology. And if it is same, then you may not be able, you should not be allowed to create another object by that name. So ontology will actually bound you. I mean, the rights for having ontology in the system will be totally with the people who will be creating that system. Should I allow that this ontology? Should I allow this ontology? Which ontology is better? Author is better, writer is better. Better. Movie is better or film is better? So you have to choose it before creating an ontology. So you will not create, you will not choose that. But if you take that systematic examples while designing this system, then you should provide such type of facility for choosing or changing. Is it understandable? So all the examples are here. I had asked him to take 3.2, and 3.2 is here. So you can circulate 3.2 to everybody. And they're simple examples, they're not very difficult. Just everywhere there is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So you can understand how simple it is. So in brief, I covered MO. So now in details, if you want to know what is MO, go through those examples, create your own examples like that lecture, CS101 or something. So just to understand. And then look at the schema. I think there would be people who can help you in knowing whether the schema is proper or not, or it confines to this model. If it doesn't confine to this model, then the schema will have to be changed. I had looked at the schema long back, but I don't remember. So probably if I get a chance, I'll look into that schema. So, but questions are important. In the morning I said, questions are very important. Two-way communication is better, right? What if you had a mobile which would allow you to use as a walkie-talkie? One-way communication. But the thesis is around 139 pages, so don't read 139 pages, read what is appropriate. And also there is a algebra for this. What you saw is a set theory, but there is an algebra for it. Go next, 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 those have been implemented. That's called EMMA algebra, EMMA. So you know what is an algebra, right? Like in what algebra you have in databases? Relational algebra, same. But this is object based, where you want to say next, or no, I go to the next, or I want to iterate, or I want to do something. You know, get me that particular object. So algebra will tell you what to do, and there are a lot of examples given. How to use that algebra properly. So maybe you can look at that algebra also, and if you can build it, see, I believe that is slow because the algebra is not implemented properly. Otherwise it would have been faster. So if you can look at that algebra, create that algebraic querying, then it will be faster. That layer is required. Otherwise, your databases would have never been faster. The relational algebra did everything. You know, really, it would have never been faster. Indexes and all those things have really helped databases. Query algebra is there. So how to query? You can look at this. Once you understand this model, it is easy. Seventh standard, eighth standard, you do algebra, no? Ninth standard, tenth standard. Model you may not do at seventh standard, eighth standard. Model is something that is more important, you know. Model. And now how you do it inside, if you read it, it's quite easy to understand, not very difficult. And if you have any problem, probably you can contact me, but maybe through them or whatever. Or I don't know, what is the mechanism, what is the process? So whatever is the process, I'll be there available.